Hey, welcome back, you guys, to another year of timber framing here with the Northford Timber Framers. Believe it or not, I'm going to start out this morning talking about this Oliver 30-inch bandsaw. It's a 217, was made in Grand Rapids, Michigan. The year that it was built is 1949. Fabulous saw. We do our timber frame braces on this. We resaw the stock. We cut the tenons. We do our peg stock on this. We have a couple of guys in our group who are having a problem with crowning the tires on their bandsaw. So the bandsaw wheels have these hard, hard rubber tires that are mounted to them with an adhesive. And the physics of the way this wheel works is that this rubber tire needs to be crowned. So it needs to be higher in the center than it is at the edges. Because if it's not, what will happen is this very sharp bandsaw blade can get thrown right off. So back in the mid-70s, I worked in a pattern shop in New Haven, Connecticut, and I was officially a pattern maker's apprentice. But the 5 years I spent working in the pattern shop as an apprentice presented me with a woodworking foundation that actually is pretty priceless. And I've been able to entwine my pattern maker experience with timber framing and dovetailing and building furniture and all these woodworking endeavors that I've been involved in for nearly 40 years. You need to make yourself a tool, which is just a simple wooden stick, which as I measure it, is 1 1/4 by 1 1/4. You want to make it out of hardwood. You want to make it out of hard maple or preferably white oak. The fixture is 28 inches long. You want to cut an arc what I would guess to be about a 4-inch radius. Or 8-inch diameter, and you'll see why that's cut there. And then what we did is we have some very heavy grit sandpaper that's taped onto the stick, just some electrician's tape. You want to tape one here, and you want to tape a swath of heavy grit sandpaper on this other end, which the center of it is about 8 inches from the end, and it's looking like it's about 2 inches wide. So you want to start with this homemade tool or wooden fixture. And then what you want to do is you want to clamp a couple of tool rests. So you want to find some good material in your shop that you can make a steady rest. That will actually is where the fixture or the tool will sit on. So the faint-hearted craftsmen shouldn't try this. Somebody may look and say, oh, that's crazy, and that's not the way you should do this. But it's how we did it in the pattern shop back in the 70s. And I learned from a pattern maker who was a World War II POW, fabulous man, with this wheel actually spinning, which we could start it and do it, you take your tool rest with the sandpaper and you come in to the very edge of that tire that you're trying to round so that As the bandsaw is turning, you're actually cutting off or sanding off, if you will, material off the edge of the tire. Now, you want to hold this with two hands. I'm actually pushing it against the housing of the bandsaw, and you're going to want to pull in very gently. Don't do it with a big bite. You want to do it until you can feel how much material you're removing. And you want to sand the tire at the edge. What I do is I sand the tire at the edge till it comes down, till it shows it's about a 32nd thick. The harder side is to do the back side of this wheel. So that's where this arch cutout comes in. Once again, you're going to use your tool rest, and then when it starts, this arch is going to actually relax itself right into the housing of the bandsaw until you contact the backside of that tire. Wear a mask, you're going to find, and wear safety glasses, you're going to find that you get black dust. So what you want to do is stop after a while, let the saw stop, then you want to feel with your hand to see that you can feel a crown or a high spot in the bandsaw tire. Okay, you guys, so hopefully you can hear me over the bandsaw, but I'm actually, as I talk to you at this moment, I'm actually removing material off the bandsaw wheel. I want to pay attention to what I'm doing here, but it's really very simple. and I can feel that, I actually can smell that I'm removing rubber material. And so it's really not that hard, and it's pretty easy to just back away from it. You're gonna have a tense moment when you first begin to do it, and you're gonna realize, hey, this isn't so bad. And as you can see, my body is in no way near getting sucked into the bandsaw. You may not have an Oliver bandsaw. You may have a Delta or a Powermatic, or, you know, we could go on and on with how many manufacturers of bandsaws there are. But you could use the lesson that you're getting here for any style, for any kind of bandsaw. You may have to just make your own fixtures, do your own measuring. So let's open the top wheel. If you guys look at this top wheel, you'll see that it's actually segmented off with numbers. 16, 8, 15, 4. What it was these guys, when they went back to lunch every day, when they would shut the bandsaw off and the wheel would be turning, they would open the top, they'd have a board on the wall, and guys would put down money with what number this was going to stop at. So they used to gamble every day before they had their lunch, and of course the winner probably took a handful of quarters. Let's talk about crowning the top tire. The way you would have to do this would be to remove this upper guard and the guide. This whole arm would unbolt and come apart in a few minutes on any bandsaw. Then what you would want to do is build yourself a tool rest that would sit on top of your table. The tool rest would consist of possibly three pieces. Two vertical pieces the same length, which should come up to a height of about here. So vertical piece, then a horizontal piece that would go across. You'd want to screw it together, put a few braces on it. You would want to then clamp this wooden fixture to the top of your table. The idea is you need to make a tool rest for this tool. So the tool would rest on the tool rest, and you'd be using this one to pull back against the tire to round it. Or you also could use the same side that you used before to rest on the tool rest and to round it this way, and then your tool would, the fixture would rest on the tool rest as you rounded the back of the top tire. It's easier to do the bottom. You do the bottom wheel with the blade off. Okay, very important. You crown the bottom bandsaw wheel with the blade off. You have to put the blade on the top, otherwise the top wheel wouldn't spin. Make sense? The bandsaw blade is what spins the top wheel. So I would advise you to use a thin blade if you have one, a quarter inch blade possibly. And also I would advise you to use a blade that was worn out, that didn't have a lot of set in the teeth. I would estimate, once I built a fixture for this, around 15 or 20 minutes to do the top, around 15 minutes to do the bottom. Once your bandsaw tires are trued, they're gonna last on your bandsaw for 30 years. They're gonna last a long, long time. You need to have a good bandsaw. It needs to be tuned up. I don't think I could guess how many thousand white oak pegs for a timber frame we've made on this bandsaw. So the real lesson here, you guys, is to be careful truing your bandsaw tires, and don't do it if you don't feel comfortable with it. And this is the way it was done by a pattern maker probably from 1900 until 1980. I saw it practiced by the other pattern makers. I was trained to do this, and I've showed many other guys how to true their bandsaw tires this way. Thank you.